And environment part 1. In the nature we observe presence of two main components. First, organism, and second, their environment. An ecosystem is a functional unit of nature where organisms interact with each other and their surroundings. There are many external forces or conditions which can affect the living organisms in one or the other way. They are called as factors. The sum of all such factors forms the environment. The place where a particular organism lives is called habitat. Then ecological niche. It involves not merely the place occupied by the organism, but also its functional role in the community. So, there are three main aspects. 1. Spatial or habitat niche, the physical space occupied by the organism. Then trophic niche, the trophic position of the organism and its functional role. Then multidimensional or hypervolume niche, position of the organism in the environmental gradient. The concept of ecological niche, thus significant in ecology to understand the differences between the species at same physical place or at different places or the same species at more than one location. So first, ecosystem or ecological system. It is the whole biotic community in a given area plus its abiotic environment. It is a system which is formed due to the interaction among all the living organisms living in a particular given area and also their interaction with their physical environment. There are two main kinds of ecosystem. First is natural, then artificial. The natural ecosystem operate under natural conditions. They may be terrestrial or aquatic. Artificial ecosystem, these are man-engineered and maintained artificially by man. For example, an aquarium. For study of any ecosystem, we have to consider its structure and function. Here the structure includes, first, the composition of biological community, that is species, numbers, etc. Then second, the quantity and distribution of non-living material as nutrients, water, etc. And third, the range or gradient of conditions of existence such as temperature, light, etc. So, the components of ecosystem. An ecosystem has two main components, abiotic and biotic. First, abiotic components. These include climate, organic compounds as proteins, carbohydrates, lipids and inorganic substances like calcium, magnesium, iron, etc. Then biotic components, these include the living organisms. They may be autotrophic, that is producers and converters, or heterotrophic. Now the heterotrophic organisms are of two types. One, macro consumers. These are herbivorous and carnivorous. The herbivorous are primary consumers, while the carnivores or omnivores may be secondary or tertiary consumers. The microconsumers are commonly decomposers. They are saprophytes and include bacteria and fungi. Now, about ecosystem structures and pattern. There are two recognized spatial patterns. One, zonation. This pattern occurs horizontally along the ground. Density and distribution of species vary along a horizontal gradient. Then stratification, it occurs vertically determined by height of organisms. For example, forest community. Then productivity of ecosystem. It refers to the rate of production. That means the amount of organic matter, biomass, accumulated in any unit time. It may be 1. Primary productivity. It is associated with green plants or microorganisms. It can be considered as the rate at which the Radiant, that means solar energy, is converted and stored by the producers. It is further classified into two. One, gross primary productivity, which is the total rate of photosynthesis. It is estimated in terms of either chlorophyll content or photosynthetic number, as CO2 fixed per gram, chloroform per hour. Then net primary productivity, it is the actual amount of organic matter stored by green plants apart from its use in respiration. 2. Secondary productivity, it is the rate of energy storage at the level of consumers. The consumers use the food material directly or indirectly from the producer and convert it into different forms. 3. Net productivity, it is equivalent to net primary production minus consumption by the heterotrophic organisms. It is expressed as production of C grams per m square per day. Then decomposition. For the stability of an ecosystem, as the production of organic matter is important, its consumption and finally decomposition is also equally important. The important steps in decomposition are fragmentation, leaching, catabolism, humification and mineralization. It takes place through the detritus food chain, which starts from the dead organic matter. Detrivorous, like earthworm, break down the detritus into smaller particles, which is known as fragmentation. Water-soluble inorganic nutrients go down into the soil horizon, get precipitated at salts, which is leaching. Then fungal and bacterial enzymes degrade detritus into simple inorganic substance, it is catabolism. Partially decomposed organic matter is called humus, and humification means the formation of humus, which is a dark-colored amorphous substance. It undergoes decomposition at very slow rate by some microbes known as mineralization. Rate of decomposition is faster in warm and moist environment. Then about pyramids of number, biomass and energy. Pyramid of number shows the relationships between producers, herbivores and carnivores at successive trophic level in terms of their numbers. The number goes on reducing from base to the apex of the pyramid. So the pyramid is upright. Then pyramid of biomass. In the most of the ecosystems, the pyramid of biomass is upright, like pyramid of numbers. Producers are always more in biomass than herbivores and carnivores. However, there are exceptions. The pyramid of biomass in sea is always inverted because the biomass of fishes is more than that of phytoplankton. Then pyramid of energy. It is always upright. Now about energy flow in ecosystem. Energy flow is unidirectional. That means energy captured by autotrophs does not go back to the solar input, or the energy which passes to herbivores does not go back to autotrophs. The amount of energy flow decreases with successive trophic levels. Producers capture 1-5% of the photosynthetically active radiation, and remaining unutilized energy is released in the form of heat. A small portion of the energy captured is utilized for respiration of producers, and a portion of net primary production, almost 10%, is used to provide food for herbivores. The unutilized net primary production is ultimately added to detritus, which is energy for detrivores and decomposers. Energy obtained by herbivores is used in metabolism, and unutilized portion of it is added to the detritus as feces, released in the form of heat. The remaining energy in herbivores is used as food by carnivores, or it is transferred to decomposers when the herbivores die. In this step, only about 10% of energy from herbivore is used by carnivore. Cost of respiration increases markedly along successive trophic levels. Shorter the food chain, greater would be the available food energy, and as the length of food chain increases, there is corresponding more loss of energy. The nutrient cycles in ecosystem. First, carbon cycle. It is estimated that 71% of the global carbon is found in the dissolved form in oceans. Reservoir of carbon is found in hydrosphere, that means oceans, lithosphere, that means fossil fuels, and in atmosphere as carbon dioxide. In ocean, it remains stored as bicarbonates, as limestone and marble rocks. Now, the cyclic pathway of carbon. The carbon enters the biotic components of ecosystem through green plants, photosynthetic bacteria, and through photoplanktons in the aquatic ecosystem. These are called producer and carry out photosynthesis by taking in the atmospheric CO2 and make carbohydrates and oxygen. Then, carbohydrates are used as source of food by animals. Thus, carbon fixed by producers enters the food chain and keep moving through different living organisms. They are returned to the soil in the form of detritus. Then, the decomposers break down the larger organic compounds into simpler ones and then into inorganic molecules. In this process, small amount of CO2 is returned back to atmosphere. Then, CO2 is released into atmosphere by respiration of producers and consumers. Then, burning of fossil fuels in automobiles and machineries to produce energy, burning of wood, organic debris also release CO2 in atmosphere. Then, volcanic eruption and hot springs also release CO2 into atmosphere. Then, phosphorus cycle. It is an example of sedimentary cycle having its reservoir not in atmosphere, but the greatest reservoir of phosphate is in the insoluble ferric and calcium phosphate in rocks. It is by weathering of rocks, inorganic phosphorus is added to soil solution. Phosphatizing bacteria add phosphorus ions by converting the organic phosphorus from detritus. Now, the cyclic pathway of phosphorus. Phosphorus is major constituent of DNA, RNA, ATP. That means all organisms need phosphorus. Now, autotrophs means plants take up phosphorus in the form of phosphate as roots of the plants absorb it from the soil. Then animals obtain phosphorus from the plants. Animals need large quantities of phosphorus to make bones, teeth and shells. When animals or plants die, the phosphate may be returned to the soil or water by the decomposers. The mining of phosphate and its use as fertilizer greatly accelerates the phosphorus cycle. Marine birds play unique role in the phosphorus cycle. They eat marine fishes, which are rich in phosphorus. Their excreta called guano deposits contain high levels of phosphorus, and thus marine birds return phosphorus from the ocean to the land. Then about ecological succession. A given area has different population. The sum total of all the population in a given habitat is community. Its structure changes as the environmental conditions change. This change is sequential, in a definite order, and lead finally to be a climax community which is in near equilibrium with the environment. This gradual change in the species composition of a given area is ecological succession. There are two main types. One, primary succession. It starts in the area where no living organisms ever existed, such as bare rock, newly formed pond, etc. The secondary succession starts in an area which has lost all the living organisms once existed. For example, burn or cut forest. The developmental stages of ecological succession are called serial stages. The organisms of the first serial stage are pioneers. The pioneers, mainly they are autotrophs, face the adverse conditions and establish themselves, reproduce and survive in that area. Gradually, the pioneers modify the physical environment that enables new species to arrive in that area. It is followed by arrival of heterotrophs, and finally, a stable community establishes in that area, which is the climax community. The amount of water determines the pattern of ecological succession in the area. Accordingly, there are two types. One, hydrarch succession, that is hydrozer, and xerarch succession, that is xerozer. Hydrarch succession occurs in the areas where water is present in plenty. The transformation takes place from a pool of water to swamp, then marsh, and then mesic condition. The desert areas show xerarch succession. It begins with growth of lichens, which produce acids to dissolve rocks and bring about weathering of rocks that result in soil formation. Both these succession lead to mesic condition, that means neither too dry nor too wet. Then, ecological services. A wide range of economic, environmental, and aesthetic benefits provided to the human beings by the ecological processes are collectively called ecological services. First, fixation of carbon dioxide. It is the service provided by the environment which supports life of all living organisms. During this process, the abiotic ecological factors such as sunlight, water, CO2 are used from the vicinity of green plants. Then, release of oxygen. Oxygen is released as a byproduct of photosynthesis. It purifies the air. It takes part in ozone layer formation also, that protects us from harmful ultraviolet rays. Then, pollination. Wind is an agent for pollination in many plants, and water is for aquatic plants. There are many insects and birds which are pollinators. After pollination only, there is fertilization and formation of seeds and fruits. Then we'll come to environmental issues. In that, first, agrochemicals and their effects. Intensive use of pesticides over the years has posed severe environmental problems. This include contamination of soil and groundwater, reduced productivity, development of pesticide resistance among the pests. The agrochemicals can move to deeper layers of soil through percolation of water and finally reach the groundwater reserve. Various factors which influence leaching of agrochemicals into groundwater are amount of rainfall, soil drainage, depth of water table, soil texture, etc. They also include agronomic factors like timing, rate and method of pesticide application, etc. Several agrochemicals are also found contaminating food. They cause hazardous effects on humans, animals and crop plants. Most of the agrochemicals are general poisons and not specific for a particular species of pest. Thus, the natural productivity of the soil is greatly affected. Many pesticides are non-biodegradable, so they cause bioaccumulation. To avoid ill effects of agrochemicals, only biopesticides and biofertilizers should be used. Then, solid waste management. Solid waste is everything that is commonly called trash. Rapid increase in population and change life cycle has increased the amount of solid waste tremendously. Open burning dumps reduces the volume of waste, but that is hazardous as generally it is not burned to completion, and open dumps serve as the breeding place for rats and flies. Landfills also are inadequate as the amount of garbage, especially in metros, has increased very much. So there is a danger of seepage of chemicals from these landfills which may pollute underground water sources. So this should be the citizen's role. All the waste can be categorized into three types: 1. Biodegradable, 2. Non-biodegradable, and 3. Recyclable. Every citizen should try to reduce garbage generation and minimize the use of non-biodegradable products. One should refuse polythene carry bags and start carrying cloth carry bags. Then greenhouse effect and global warming. The solar energy is carried to the earth in three forms: ultraviolet radiations, visible light, and infrared and radio waves. The harmful UV radiations are absorbed by the ozone layer on the stratosphere before the sun rays reach the earth's surface. The infrared rays pass through the carbon dioxide layer in the lower region of the atmosphere. Since the infrared radiation has heating effect, it warms up the earth, its atmosphere, and various objects. A part of infrared radiations falling on the earth's surface and which have longer wavelengths is reflected back into the outer space. They cannot escape out from the CO2 layer present in the atmosphere. CO2, along with methane, nitrogen oxides, and chlorofluorocarbon, can absorb infrared radiations reflected from Earth's surface. Therefore, the blanket of these gases in the atmosphere traps reflected infrared rays and produces heat on the Earth's surface. This is greenhouse effect, which is the main cause of global warming. The gases of the atmosphere that cause rise in Earth's temperature are greenhouse gases. In the Antarctic region, there is formation of a large area of thin ozone layer, which is called ozone hole. Then deforestation, the permanent removal, decrease, or deterioration of forest and woodland is deforestation. The major effects of deforestation are extinction of species, reduced soil fertility, soil erosion, change in climate, shortage of timber, global warming, etc. Reforestation is restoring a forest that once existed, and plantation of trees in barren and unexploited land to improve environment is afforestation. Every year, 5th June is observed as the World Environment Day.